Thank you for being here. I promised some of you all a few days ago that as soon as the opportunity presented itself, I would give you a complete rundown on what we were doing and, more importantly, why we were doing it, the strategy behind what we were doing. I've been asked by Secretary Cheney to do that this evening, and so if you will bear with me, we're going to go through a briefing. I apologize to the folks over here who won't be able to see the charts, but we're going to go through a complete briefing of the operation. This goes back to 7 August to 17 January. You recall we started our deployment on the 7th of August. Basically, what we started out against was a couple of 100,000 Iraqis that were in the Kuwait theater of operation. I don't have to remind you all that we brought over initially defensive forces in the form of the 101st, the 82nd, the 24th Mechanized Infantry Division, the 3rd Armored Cavalry, and in essence, we had them arrayed to the south behind the Saudi task force. Also, there were Arab forces over here in this area arrayed in defensive positions, and that, in essence, is the way we started. In the middle of November, the decision was made to increase the force because by that time, huge numbers of Iraqi forces had flowed into the area, and generally in the disposition as they're shown right here, and therefore we increased the forces and built up more forces. I would tell you that at this time, we made a very deliberate decision to align all of those forces within the boundary looking north towards Kuwait, this being King Khalid Military City over here. So we aligned those forces so it very much looked like they were all aligned directly on the Iraqi position. We also at that time had a very active naval presence out in the Gulf, and we made sure that everybody understood about that naval presence. One of the reasons why we did that is because it became very apparent to us early on that the Iraqis were quite concerned about an amphibious operation across the shores to liberate Kuwait, this being Kuwait City. They put a very, very heavy barrier of infantry along here, and they proceeded to build an extensive barrier that went all the way down and around and up the side of Kuwait. Basically, the problem we were faced with was this. When you looked at the troop numbers, they really outnumbered us about 3-2. And if when you consider the number of combat service support people we have, that's logisticians and that sort of thing in our armed forces, as far as fighting troops, we were really outnumbered 2-1. In addition to that, they had about 4,700 tanks versus our 3,500 when the buildup was complete, and they had a great deal more artillery than we do. I think any student of military strategy would tell you that in order to attack a position, you should have a ratio of approximately 3-1 in favor of the attacker. And in order to attack a position that is heavily dug in and barricaded, such as the one we had here, you should have a ratio of 5-1 in the way of troops in favor of the attacker. So you can see basically what our problem was at that time. We were outnumbered as a minimum 3-2 as far as troops were concerned. We were outnumbered as far as tanks were concerned. And we had to come up with some way to make up the difference. Next chart, please. I apologize for the busy nature of this chart, but I think it's very important for you to understand exactly what our strategy was. What you see here is a color coding where green is a go sign or a good sign as far as our forces are concerned. Yellow would be a caution sign and red would be a stop sign. Green represents units that have been attrited below 50% strength. The yellow are units that are between 50 and 75% strength, and of course the red are units that are over 75% strength. What we did, of course, was start an extensive air campaign, and I briefed you in quite some detail on that in the past. One of the purposes I told you at that time of that extensive air campaign was to isolate the Kuwaiti theater of operation by taking out all the bridges and supply lines that ran between the north and the southern part of Iraq. That was to prevent reinforcement and supply coming into the southern part of Iraq and the Kuwaiti theater of operation. We also conducted a very heavy bombing campaign, and many people questioned why the extensive bombing campaign. This is the reason why. It was necessary to reduce these forces down to a strength that was that made them weaker, particularly along the front line barrier that we had to go through. We continued our heavy operations out in the sea because we wanted the Iraqis to continue to believe that we were going to conduct a massive amphibious operation in this area. And I think many of you recall the number of amphibious rehearsals we had to include Imminent Thunder that was written about quite extensively. for many reasons. But we continued to have those operations because we wanted him to concentrate his forces, which he did. I think this is probably one of the most important parts of the entire briefing I could talk about. As you know, very early on, we took out the Iraqi Air Force. We knew that he had very, very limited reconnaissance means, and therefore, when we took out his Air Force, for all intents and purposes, we took out his ability to see what we were doing down here in Saudi Arabia. Once we had taken out his eyes, we did what could best be described as the Hail Mary play in football. I think you recall when the quarterback is desperate for a touchdown at the very end, what he does is he steps up behind the center, and all of a sudden, every single one of his receivers goes way out to the to one flank, and they all run down the field as fast as they possibly can and into the end zone, and he lobs the ball. In essence, that's what we did. When we knew that he couldn't see us anymore, we did a massive movement of troops all the way out to the west, to the extreme west, because at that time we knew that he was still fixed in this area with the vast majority of his forces, and once the air campaign started, he would be incapable of moving out to counter this move, even if he knew we made it. There were some addition of troops out in this area, but they did not have the capability nor the time to put in the barrier that had been described by Saddam Hussein as an absolutely impenetrable tank barrier that no one would ever get through. I believe those were his words. So this was absolutely an extraordinary move, I must tell you. I can't recall any time in the annals of military history when this number of forces have moved over this distance to put themselves in a position to be able to attack. But what's more important, and I think it's very, very important that I make this point, and that's these logistics bases. Not only did we move the troops out there, but we literally moved thousands and thousands of tons of fuel, of ammunition, of spare parts, of water, and of food out here into this area, because we wanted to have enough supplies on hand so that if we launched this and we got into a slugfest battle, which we very easily could have gotten into, we'd have enough supplies to last for 60 days. It was an absolutely gigantic accomplishment, and I can't give credit enough to the logisticians and the transporters who were able to pull this off, to the superb support we had from the Saudi government, the literally thousands and thousands of drivers, really of every national origin who helped us in this move out here. And of course, great credit goes to the commanders of these units who were also able to maneuver their forces out here and put them in this position. But as a result, by the 23rd of February, what you found is this situation. The front lines had been attrited down to a point where all of these units were at 50% or below. The second level, basically, that we had to face, and these were the real tough fighters that we were worried about right here, were attrited to someplace between 50 and 75%, although we still had the Republican Guard located here and here, and part of the Republican Guard in this area that were very strong, and the Republican Guard up in this area strong. And we continued to hit the bridges all across this area to make absolutely sure that no more reinforcements came into the battle. This was a situation on the 23rd of February. Next, please. I shouldn't forget these fellows. That SF stands for Special Forces. We put special forces deep into the enemy territory. They went out on strategic reconnaissance for us, and they let us know what was going on out there, and they were the eyes that were out there. It's very important that I not forget those folks. Next, please. This, then, was the morning of the 24th. Our plan initially had been to start over here in this area and do exactly what the Iraqis thought we were going to do, and that's take them on head-on into their most heavily defended area. Also, at the same time, we launched amphibious feints and naval gunfire in this area so that they continued to think that we were going to be attacking along this coast and therefore fix their forces in this position. Our hope was that by fixing the forces in this position and with this attack through here in this position, we would basically keep the forces here and they wouldn't know what was going on out in this area. And I believe we succeeded in that very well. At 4 o'clock in the morning, the Marines, the 1st Marine Division and the 2nd Marine Division, launched attacks through the barrier system. They were accompanied by the 2nd, the Tiger Brigade, U.S. Army Tiger Brigade of the 2nd Armored Division. At the same time, over here, two Saudi task forces also launch a penetration through this barrier. But while they were doing that, at 4 o'clock in the morning over here, the 6th French Armored Division, accompanied by a brigade of the 82nd Airborne, also launched an overland attack to their objective up in this area, Al Samman Airfield. And we were held up a little bit by the weather, but by 8 o'clock in the morning, the 101st Airborne Air Assault launched an air assault deep in the enemy's territory to establish a forward operating base in this location right here. Let me talk about each one of those moves. First of all, the Saudis over here on the East Coast did a terrific job. They went up against a very, very tough barrier system. They breached the barrier very, very effectively. They moved out aggressively and continued their attack up the coast. I can't say enough about the two Marine divisions. If I use words like brilliant, it would really be an underdescription of the absolutely superb job that they did in breaching the so-called impenetrable barrier. It was a classic, absolutely classic military breaching of a very, very tough minefield, barbed wire, fire trenches type barrier. They went through the first barrier like it was water. They went across into the second barrier line, even though they were under artillery fire at the time. They continued to open up that breach, and then they brought both divisions streaming through that breach. Absolutely superb operation, a textbook, and I think it'll be studied for many, many years to come as the way to do it. I would also like to say that the French did an absolutely superb job of moving out rapidly to take their objective out here, and they were very, very successful, as was the 101st. And again, we still had the special forces located in this area. What we found was as soon as we breached these obstacles here and started bringing pressure, we started getting a large number of surrenders. And I think I talked to some of you all about that this evening when I briefed you on the evening of the 24th. We found we got a large number of surrenders. We also found that these forces right here were getting a large number of surrenders and were meeting with a great deal of success. We were worried about the weather. The weather turned out was going to get pretty bad the next day, and we were worried about launching this air assault. And we also started to have a huge number of atrocities of really the most unspeakable type committed in downtown Kuwait City, to include reports that the desalinization plant had been destroyed. And when we heard that, we were quite concerned about what might be going on. Based upon that and the situation as it was developing, we made a decision that rather than wait the following morning to launch the remainder of these forces, that we would go ahead and launch those forces that afternoon. Next. So this was a situation you saw the afternoon of the 24th. The Marines continued to make great progress going through the breach in this area and were moving rapidly north. The Saudi task force on the East Coast was also moving rapidly to the north and making very, very good progress. We launched another Egyptian Arab force in this location and another Saudi force in this location, again to penetrate the barrier, but once again to make the enemy continue to think that we're doing exactly what he wanted us to do, and that's make a headlong assault into a very, very tough barrier system, a very, very tough mission for these folks here. But at the same time, what we did is continued to attack with the French. We launched an attack on the part of the entire 7th Corps, where the 1st Infantry Division went through, breached an obstacle and minefield barrier here, established quite a large breach through which we passed the 1st British Armored Division. At the same time, we launched the 1st Armored Division, the 3rd Armored Division, and because of our deception plan and the way it worked, we didn't even have to worry about a barrier. We just went right around the enemy and were behind him in no time at all. And the 2nd Armored Cavalry Division. And I ought to talk, and the 24th Mech Division also launched out here in the far west, and I ought to talk about the 101st because this is an important point. Once the 101st had their forward operating base established here, they then went ahead and launched into the Tigris and the Euphrates Valley. There's a lot of people who are still saying that the object of the United States of America was to capture Iraq and cause a downfall of the entire country of Iraq. Ladies and gentlemen, when we were here, we were 150 miles away from Baghdad, and there was nobody between us and Baghdad. If it had been our intention to take Iraq, if it had been our intention to destroy the country, if it had been our intention to overrun the country, we could have done it unopposed, for all intents and purposes, from this position at that time. But that was not our intention. We had never said it was our intention. Our intention was purely to eject the Iraqis out of Kuwait and destroy the military power that had come in here. So this was the situation at the end of February the 24th in the afternoon. Next, please. The next 2 days went exactly like we thought they would go. The Saudis continued to make great progress up on the eastern flank, keeping the pressure off the Marines on the flank here. The special forces went out and started operating small boat operations out in this area to help clear mines, but also to threaten the flanks here and to continue to make them think we were in fact going to conduct amphibious operations. The Saudi forces that came in and took the, and Arab forces that came in and took these two initial objectives turned to come in on the flank heading towards Kuwait City, located right in this area here. The British UK passed through and continued to attack up this flank, and of course the 7th Corps came in and attacked in this direction as shown here. The 24th Infantry Division made an unbelievable move all the way across into the Tigris and Euphrates Valley and proceeded in blocking this avenue of egress out, which was the only avenue of egress left because we continued to make sure that the bridges stayed down. So there was no way out once the 24th was in this area and the 101st continued to operate in here. The French, having succeeded in achieving all of their objectives, then set up a flanking position, a flank guard position here to make sure that no forces come in and get us from the flank. By this time, we had destroyed or rendered completely ineffective over 21 Iraqi divisions. Next, please. And of course, that then brings us to today. Where we are today is we now have a solid wall across the north of the 18th Airborne Corps, consisting of the units shown right here, attacking straight to the east. We have a solid wall here again of the 7th Corps, also attacking straight to the east. The forces that they are fighting right now are the forces of the Republican Guard. Again, today we had a very significant day when the Arab forces coming from both the west and the east closed in and moved into Kuwait City, where they are now in the process of clearing Kuwait City entirely and assuring that it's absolutely secure. The 1st Marine Division continues to hold Kuwaiti International Airport. The 2nd Marine Division continues to be in a position where it blocks any egress out of the city of Kuwait so no one can leave. To date, we have destroyed over 29, destroyed or rendered inoperable. I don't like to say destroyed because that gives you the visions of absolutely killing everyone, and that's not what we're doing. But we have rendered completely ineffective over 29 Iraqi divisions, and the gates are closed. There is no way out of here. There is no way out of here. And the enemy is fighting us in this location right here. We continue, of course, to have overwhelming air power. The air has done a terrific job from start to finish in supporting the ground forces. And we also have had great support from the Navy, both in the form of naval gunfire and in the support of carrier air. That's the situation at the present time. Next, please. Peace is not without a cost. These have been the U.S. casualties to date. As you can see, these are the casualties that we had in the air war. Then, of course, we had the terrible misfortune of the Scud attack the other night, which again, because the weapon malfunctioned, it caused death, unfortunately, rather than a proper function. And then, of course, these are the casualties from the ground war to death, the total being as shown here. Next. Hold it, hold it, hold on for 1 second. 1 second is up. Next week. We'll put all these charts that have been available for you afterwards. Now, I would just like to comment briefly about that casualty chart. The loss of one human life is intolerable to any of us who are in the military. But I would tell you that casualties of that order of magnitude, considering the job that's been done and the number of forces that are involved, is almost miraculous as far as the late number of casualties. It'll never be miraculous to the families of those people, but it is miraculous. Anyhow, this is what's happened to date with the Iraqis. They started out with over 4,000 tanks. As of today, we have over 3,000 confirmed destroyed, and I do mean destroyed or captured. And as a matter of fact, that number is low because you can add 700 to that as a result of the battle that's going on right now with the Republican Guard. So that number is very, very high, and we've almost completely destroyed the offensive capability of the Iraqi forces in the Kuwaiti theater of operations. The armored vehicle count is also very, very high, and of course you can see we're doing great damage to the artillery. The battle is still going on, and I suspect that these numbers will mount rather considerably. Next. I wish I could give you a better number on this, to be very honest with you. This is just a wild guess. It's an estimate that was sent to us by the field today at noontime, but the prisoners out there are so heavy and so extensive, and obviously we're not in the business of going around counting noses at this time to determine precisely what the exact number is. But we're very, very confident that we have well over 50,000 prisoners of war at this time, and that number is mounting on a continuing basis. I would remind you that the war is continuing to go on. Even as we speak right now, there's fighting going on out there. Even as we speak right now, there are incredible acts of bravery going on. This afternoon, we had an F-16 pilot shot down. We had contact with him. He had a broken leg on the ground. Two helicopters from the 101st, they didn't have to do it, but they went in to try and pull that pilot out. One of them was shot down, and we're still in the process of working through that. But that's the kind of thing that's going on that battlefield right now. It is not a Nintendo game. It is a tough battlefield where people are risking their lives at all time, and there's great heroes out there, and we'll all be very, very proud of it. That's the campaign to date. That's the strategy to date, and I'd now be very happy to take any questions anyone might have. Yes,
sir. As you showed there, with the attrition rates of the various forces, was almost the exact reverse of what most of us thought was happening. It showed the frontline troops attrited to 75% or more, and the Republican Guards, which a lot of public focus was on when we were covering the air war, attrited at less than 75. Why is that? I mean, how did it come to pass?
Put that to start up again, Roger Lee, please. Let me tell you how we did this. We started off, of course, against the strategic targets. I briefed you on that before. At the same time, we were hitting the Republican Guard. But the Republican Guard, you must remember, is a mechanized armor force for the most part that is very, very well dug in and very, very well spread out. So in initial stages of the game, we were hitting the Republican Guard heavily, but we were hitting them with strategic type bombers rather than pinpoint precision bombers. For lack of a better word, what happened is the air campaign shifted from the strategic phase into the theater. And we knew all along that this was the important area. The nightmare scenario for all of us would have been to go through, get hung up in this breach right here, and then have the enemy artillery rain chemical weapons down on troops that were in a gaggle in the breach right there. That was the nightmare scenario. So one of the things that we felt we must have established is an absolute, as much destruction as we could possibly get of the artillery, the direct support artillery that would be firing on that wire. That's why we shifted it in the very latter days. We absolutely punished this area very heavily because that was the first challenge. Once we got through this and we're moving, then it's a different war. Then we're fighting our kind of war. Before we get through that, we're fighting their kind of war, and that's what we didn't want to have to do. At the same time, we continued to attrit the Republican Guard, and that's why I would tell you that again, the figures that we're giving you are conservative. They always have been conservative, but we promised you at the outset we weren't going to give you anything inflated. We're going to give you the best we had. Yes, sir. Right.
You seem to have about, he seems to have about 500 or 600 tanks left out of more than 4,000, as just an example. I wonder if in an overview, despite these enormously illustrative pictures, you could say what's left of the Iraqi army in terms of how long could it be before he could ever be a regional threat or a threat to the region again?
Well, there's not enough left of it at all for him to be a regional threat to the region, offensive regional threat. As you know, he's got a very large army, but most of the army that is left north of the Tigris-Euphrates Valley is an infantry army. It's not an armored army. It's not an armor-heavy army, which means it really isn't an offensive army. So it doesn't have enough left unless someone chooses to rearm them in the future.
What the hell was that?
Sure. You said you got all these divisions along the border which were seriously attrited. It figures to be about 200,000 troops maybe that were there. You've got 50,000 prisoners. Where's the rest of them?
There was a very, very large number of dead in these units, a very, very large number of dead. We even found them when we went into the units ourselves and found them in the trench lines. There were very heavy desertions. At one point, we had reports of desertion rates of more than 30% of the units that were along the front here. As you know, we had quite a large number of POWs that came across, and I think it's a combination of desertion, there's a combination of people that were killed, there's a combination of the people that we've captured, and there's a combination of some other people who are just flat still running. That's it.
done so much that the job is effectively done. Can I ask you, what do you think really needs to, more to be done? Because the forces are, his forces are, if not destroyed, certainly no longer capable of posing a threat to the region. They seem to want to go home. What more has to be done?
Put the last chart up, please. The last arrow, the large arrow. If I'm to accomplish the mission that I was given, and that's to make sure that the Republican Guard is rendered incapable of conducting the type of heinous act that they've conducted so often in the past, what has to be done is these forces continue to attack across here and put the Republican Guard out of business. We're not in the business of killing them. We have PSYOPs aircraft up. We're telling them over and over again, all you got to do is get out of your tanks and move off, and you will not be killed. But they're continuing to fight, and as long as they continue to fight, we're going to continue to fight with them.
That move on the extreme left, which got within 150 miles of Baghdad, was it also part of the plan that the Iraqis might have thought that it was going to Baghdad, and would that have contributed to the deception?
I wouldn't have minded at all if they'd gotten a little bit nervous about it. I mean that very sincerely. I would have been delighted if they'd gotten very, very nervous about it. Frankly, I don't think they ever knew it was there. I think they never knew it was there until the door had already been closed on them. Yeah, right there.
Now, I'm wondering how much resistance there still is in Kuwait. And I'm wondering what you would say to people who would say the purpose of this war was to get the Iraqis out of Kuwait, and they're now out. What would you say to that public that is thinking that right now?
I would say that there was a lot more purpose of this war than just get the Iraqis out of Kuwait. The purpose of this war was to enforce the resolutions of the United Nations. There are some 12 different resolutions of the United Nations, not all of which have been accepted by Iraq to date, that I, as I understand it. Okay? But I got to tell you that in the business of the military, of a military commander, my job is not to go ahead and at some point say, well, that's great, they've just now pulled out of Kuwait. Even though they're still shooting at us, they're moving backwards, and therefore I've accomplished my mission. That's not the way you fight it, and that's not the way I would ever fight it. Back in the back. Please.
Talked about heavy press coverage of imminent thunder early on and how it helped fool the Iraqis into thinking that it was a serious operation. I wondered if you could talk about other ways in which the press contributed to the campaign.
I don't want to characterize imminent thunder as being only a deception, because it wasn't. We had every intention of conducting amphibious operations if they were necessary, and that was a very, very real rehearsal, as were the other rehearsals. I guess the one thing I would say to the press that I was delighted with is, in the very, very early stages of this operation, when we were over here building up and we didn't have very much on the ground, you all were giving us a credit for a whole lot more over here. And as a result, that gave me quite a feeling of confidence that we might not be attacked quite as quickly as I thought we were going to be attacked. Other than that, I would not like to get into the remainder of the question. Over here, yes, sir.
So, what kind of fight is going on with the Republican Guard? And is there any more fighting going on in Kuwait? Is Kuwait essentially out of action?
No. The fight that's going on with the Republican Guard right now is just a classic tank battle. You've got fire and maneuver. You've got, they are continuing to fight and shoot at us as our forces move forward, and our forces are in the business of outflanking them, taking them from the rear, using our attack helicopters, using our advanced technology. I would tell you that one of the things that has prevailed, particularly in this battle out here, is our technology. We had great weather for the air war, but right now and for the last 3 days, it's been raining out there, it's been dusty out there, there's black smoke and haze in the air. It's an infantryman's weather. God loves the infantryman, and that's just the kind of weather the infantryman likes to fight in. But I would also tell you that our sights have worked fantastically well in their ability to acquire, through that kind of dust and haze, the enemy targets. And the enemy sights have not worked that well. As a matter of fact, we've had several anecdotal reports today of enemy who were saying to us that they couldn't see anything through their sights, and all of a sudden their tank exploded when their tank was hit by our sights. So that's one of the indications of what's going on.
Or are you saying the
very tough, very, very tough air environment? Obviously, as this box gets smaller and smaller, okay, in the bad weather, it gets tougher and tougher to use the air, and therefore the air is acting more in an interdiction role than any other. Back in the back, yes.
So General, French journalist, could you tell us why the French, who went very fast in the desert in the first day, stopped in Salman and were invited to stop fighting after 36 hours?
Well, that's not exactly a correct statement. The French mission okay, on the first day was to protect our left flank. What we were interested in is making sure we can find this battlefield, both on the right and the left, and we didn't want anyone coming in and attacking these forces, which was the main attack, coming in from their left flank. So the French mission was to go out and not only seize Al-Samman, but to set up a screen across our left flank, which was absolutely vital to ensure that we weren't surprised. So they definitely did not stop fighting. They continued to perform their mission, and they performed it extraordinarily well. Yes, sir.
When Iraq's air force disappeared very early in the air war, there was speculation they might return to provide cover during the ground war. Were you expecting that? Are you surprised they never showed themselves again?
I was not expecting it. We were not expecting it, but I would tell you that we never discounted it, and we were totally prepared in the event it happened.
Have they been completely destroyed? Where are they?
There's not an airplane that's flown. I'll tell you where there are. A lot of them are dispersed throughout civilian communities in Iraq. We have a lot of indication. We have proof of that. Yeah, right here.
How many divisions of the Republican Guard now are you fighting? And any idea how long that will take?
We're probably fighting on the order of... We fought, there were a total of five of them up here, okay? One of them we had probably destroyed yesterday. We probably destroyed two more today. And I would say that leaves us a couple that we're in the process of fighting right now. Yeah.
Could I ask you two questions? First, did you think that this would turn out? I realize a great deal of strategy and planning went into it, but when it took place, did you think this would turn out to be such an easy cakewalk as it seems? And secondly, what are your impressions of Saddam Hussein as a military strategist?
First of all, if we thought it would have been such an easy fight, we definitely would not have stocked 60 days worth of supplies on these log bases. So as I told you all for a very, very long time, it is very, very important for a military commander never to assume away the capabilities of his enemy. And when you're facing an enemy that is over 500,000 strong, has the reputation that they've had of fighting for 8 years, being combat-hardened veterans, had the number of tanks and the type of equipment they had, you don't assume away anything. So we certainly did not expect it to go this way. As far as Saddam Hussein being a great military strategist, he is neither a strategist, nor is he schooled in the operational art, nor is he a tactician, nor is he a general, nor is he as a soldier. Other than that, he's a great military man. I want you to know that. Back here.
General, I wonder if you could tell us anything more about Iraqi casualties on the battlefield. You said there were large numbers. Are we talking thousands, tens of thousands? I mean, any more scale that you can give us?
No, I wish I could answer that question. As you can imagine, this has been a very fast-moving battle, as is desert warfare. And as a result, even today when I was asking for estimates, every commander out there said, we just can't give you an estimate. It went too fast. We've gone by too quickly. Yes, sir.
Very quickly, the special operations folks, could you tell us what their role was?
We don't like to talk a lot about what the special operations do, as you're well aware. But in this case, let me just cover some of the things they did. First of all, with every single Arab unit that went into battle, we had special forces troops with them. The job of those special forces was to travel and live right down at the battalion level with all those people to make sure that they could act as the communicators with friendly English-speaking units that were on their flanks, and they could also call in airstrikes as necessary. They could coordinate helicopter strikes and that sort of thing. That's one of the principal roles that they played, and was a very, very important role. Secondly, they did a great job in strategic reconnaissance for us. Thirdly, the special forces were 100% in charge of the combat search and rescue, and that's a tough mission. When a pilot gets shot down out there in the middle of nowhere, surrounded by the enemy, and you're the folks that are required to go in and go after them, that is a very tough mission, and that was one of their missions. And finally, they also did some direct action missions, period. Yes.
General, there have been reports that when the Iraqis left Kuwait City, they took with them a number of the Kuwaiti people as hostages. What can you tell us about this?
We've heard that they took up to 40,000. I think that you've probably heard the Kuwaitis themselves who were left in the city state that they were taking people and that they have taken them. So I don't think there's any question about the fact that there was a very, very large number of young Kuwaitis males taken out of that city within the last week or two. But that pales to insignificance compared to the absolutely unspeakable atrocities that occurred in Kuwait in the last week. They're not a part of the same human race the people that did that the rest of us are. I've got to pray that that's the case. Yes, sir.
About that?
No, sir. I wouldn't want to talk
about it.
Could
you give us some indication of what's happening to the forces left in Kuwait? What kind of forces are they, the size, and are they engaged at the moment? The three symbols.
You mean these up here?
No, the ones in Kuwait, the three symbols to the right.
These right here?
Yeah.
I'm not even sure they're here, okay? I think they're probably gone, okay? Because we picked up a lot of signals with people. There's a road that goes right around here and goes out that way, and I think they probably more than likely are gone. So what you're really faced with is you're ending up fighting these Republican Guard heavy mech and armor units there that are there, and basically what we want to do is capture their equipment.
Kuwait, then. So in fact, they are all out of Kuwait.
I wouldn't be the least bit surprised if they're not pockets of people all around here who are just waiting to surrender as soon as somebody uncovers them and comes to them. But we're certainly not getting any internal fighting going on across our lines of communication or any of that sort of thing. Right here.
General, not to take anything away from the Army and the Marines who made the breaching maneuvers.
I hope you don't.
But many of the reports and the pools we've got from your field commanders and the soldiers were indicating that these fortifications were not as intense or as sophisticated as they were led to believe. Was this a result of the pounding that they took that you described earlier, or is it they were perhaps overrated in the first place?
You ever been in a minefield?
No.
There's all there's got to be is one mine, and that's intense. Okay. There were plenty of mines out there. There were plenty of barbed wire. There were fire trenches that most of which we set off ahead of time. But there are still some that were out there. The Egyptian forces had to go through fire trenches. There were a lot of booby traps, a lot of barbed wire. It's not a fun place to be. I got to tell you that probably one of the toughest things that anyone ever has to do is to go up there and walk into something like that and go through it. And consider that while you're going through it and clearing it, at the same time, you're probably under fire by the enemy artillery. That's all I can say.
Was it less severe than you had even expected? I mean, we were expecting even worse.
It was less severe than we expected, but one of the things I attribute that to is the fact that we went through extensive measures to try and make it less severe. Okay, and we really did. I didn't mean to be facetious with my answer. I just got to tell you. But that is a very tough mission for any person to do, particularly in a minefield. Yes, sir.
Is the Republican Guard your only remaining military objective in Iraq? And I gather there have been some heavy engagements. How would you rate this army you faced from the Republican Guard on down?
Rating an army is a tough thing to do. A great deal of the capability of an army is its dedication to its cause and its will to fight. You can have the best equipment in the world, you can have the largest numbers in the world, but if you're not dedicated to your cause, if you don't have a will to fight, then you're not going to have a very good army. One of the things that we learned towards right prior to the initiation of the campaign that, of course, contributed, as a matter of fact, to the timing of the ground campaign is that so many people were deserting, and I think you've heard this, that the Iraqis brought down execution squads whose job was to shoot people, okay, in the front lines. And I got to tell you what, a soldier doesn't fight very hard for a leader who is going to shoot him, okay, on his own whim. That's not what military leadership is all about. And so I attribute a great deal of the failure of the Iraqi army to fight to their own leadership. They committed them to a cause that they did not believe in. They all are saying that they didn't want to be there. They didn't want to fight their fellow Arab. They were lied to. They were deceived. And when they went into Kuwait, they didn't believe in the cause. And then after they got there, they had a leadership that was so uncaring for them, okay, that they didn't properly feed them, they didn't properly give them water, and in the end, they kept them there only at the point of a gun. So I can't, now the Republican Guard is entirely different. The Republican Guard are the ones that went into Kuwait in the first place. They get paid more, they get treated better, and oh, by the way, they also were well to the rear here, okay? So they could be the first ones to bug out, okay, when the battlefield started folding, while these poor fellows up here who didn't want to be here in the first place bore the brunt of the attack. But it didn't happen. Yes, sir.
General, tell us something about the British involvement and perhaps comment on today's report of 10 dead through friendly fire?
Yeah. The British, I've got to tell you, have been absolutely superb members of this coalition from the outset. I have a great deal of admiration and respect for all the British that are out there, and particularly General Sir Peter de la Bille, who is not only a great general, but he's also become a very close personal friend of mine. They played a very, very key role in the movement of the main attack. I will tell you that what they had to do was go through this breach in one of the tougher areas because I told you they had reinforced here and there were a lot of forces here, and what the Brits had to do was go through the breach and then set up the block so that the main attack could continue on without forces over here, the mechanized forces over here, attacking that main attack in the flank. And that was the principal role of the British. They did it absolutely magnificently, and then they immediately followed up in the main attack, and they're still up there fighting right now. So they just did a great job. Yeah, right here.
40,000 Kuwaiti hostages taken by the Iraqis. Where are they right now? That's quite a few people. Are they in the line of fire? Do we know where they are?
No. We were told, and again, and this is a lot of this is anecdotal, okay? We were told that they were taken back to Basra. We were also told that some of them were taken all the way back to Baghdad. We were told 100 different reasons why they were taken. Number one, to be a bargaining chip if the time came when bargaining chips were needed. Another one was for retribution because, of course, at that time, Iraq was saying that these people were not Kuwaitis, these were citizens of Iraq, and therefore they could do anything they wanted to with them. So I just pray that they'll all be returned safely before long. Yes, sir, right.
General, the other day on television, the deputy Soviet foreign minister said that they were talking again about rearming the Iraqis. And there's some indication that the United States as well believes that Iraq needs to have a certain amount of armament to retain a balance of power. Do you feel that your troops are in jeopardy finishing this off when already the politicians are talking about rearming the Iraqis? How do you feel about that?
Well, I certainly don't want to discuss what the deputy foreign minister of the Soviet Union says. That's way out of my field. I would tell you that I'm one of the first people that said at the outset that it's not in the best interest of peace in this part of the world to destroy Iraq. And I think the President of the United States has made it very clear from the outset that our intention is not to destroy Iraq or the Iraqi people. I think that everyone has every right to legitimately defend themselves. But the one thing that's come through loud and clear over and over and over again to the people that have flown over Iraq, to the pilots that have gone in against their military installations, when you look at the war machine that they built, that war machine definitely was not a defensive war machine, and they demonstrated that more than adequately when they overran Kuwait and then called it a great military victory. Yeah.
Before starting the land phase, how much were you concerned by the Iraqi planes coming back from Iran? And do we know what happened to the Iraqi helicopters?
No, that, as I said before, we were very concerned about the return of the Iraqi planes from Iran, but we were prepared for it. We've been completely prepared for any type of air attack that the Iraqis might throw against us, and oh, by the way, we're still prepared for it. We're not going to let down our guard for one instant so long as we know that capability is there until we're sure that this whole thing is over. The helicopters are another very interesting story, and that's we knew where the helicopters were. They traditionally put their helicopters near some of their other outfits, and we tracked them very carefully. But what happened is, despite the fact that the Iraqis claim that we indiscriminately bombed civilian targets, they took their helicopters and dispersed them all over the place in civilian residential areas just as fast as they possibly could. But quite a few of them were damaged on airfields, those that we could take on airfields, but the rest of them were dispersed. Back here.
General, I'd like to ask you, you mentioned about the Saudi army forces. Could you elaborate about their role in the first day? I mean,
about what? I'm sorry, sir.
The role of Saudi army and their role from the first day?
Yeah, the Saudi army, as I said, the first thing they did was we had this marine attack that was going through here, and of course we were concerned about the forces over here again hitting the flanks. That's one of the things you just don't want to have happen to your advancing forces. So this force over here, the Eastern Task Force, had to attack up the coast to pin these enemies in this location. The forces, again, the Saudi forces over in this area, were attacked through here again to pin all the forces in this area because we didn't want those forces moving in this direction and we didn't want those forces moving in that direction. That's a tough mission, okay, because these people were being required to fight the kind of fight that the Iraqis wanted them to fight. It's a very, very tough mission. I would point out it wasn't only the Saudis. I tell you, it was the Saudis, it was the Kuwaitis, it was the Egyptians, it was the Syrians, it was the Emiris from the United Arab Emirates, it was the Bahrainis, it was the Qataris, and it was the Omanis. And I apologize if I've left anybody out, but it was a great coalition of people, all of whom did a fine job. Back here, sir.
Is there anything left of the Scud or chemical capability?
I don't know. I don't know. But we're sure going to find out if there's anything. You know, the Scuds that were being fired against Saudi Arabia came from right here. Okay? So, obviously, one of the things we're going to check on when we finally get to that location is what's left.
General, could you tell us, in terms of the air war, of how effective you think it was in speeding up the ground campaign? Because obviously it's gone much faster than you ever expected. And as a second part of that, how effective do you think the air-land battle campaign has been?
The air war obviously was very, very effective. You just can't predict about things like that. You can make your best estimates at the outset as to how quickly you will accomplish certain objectives. But of course, a lot of that depends upon the enemy and how resilient the enemy is, how tough they are, how well dug in they are. In the earlier stages, we made great progress in the air war. In the latter stages, we didn't make a lot of progress because, frankly, the enemy had burrowed down into the ground as a result of the air war. Now that, of course, made the air war a little bit tougher, but when you dig your tanks in and bury them, they're no longer tanks, they're now pillboxes. And that then makes a difference in the contribution in the ground campaign. When you don't run them for a long time, they have seals problems, they have a lot of maintenance problems and this sort of thing. So the air campaign was very, very successful and contributed a great deal. How effective was the air-ground campaign? I think it's pretty effective myself. I don't know what you all think. Right.
What do you think, as you look down the road, would be a reasonable size for the Iraqi army? And can you tell us roughly what the size is now, if the war were to stop this evening?
With regard to the size right now, at one time Saddam Hussein was claiming that he had a 7 million man army. He has a 7 million man army. They still got a pretty big army out there. How effective that army is an entirely different question. With regard to the size of the army he should have, I don't think that's my job to decide that. I think that there's an awful lot of people that live in this part of the world, and I would hope that that is a decision that's arrived at mutually by all the people in this part of the world. To contribute to peace and stability in this part of the world. I think that that's the best answer I can give right there. I'm sorry, I'll get to you all in a minute. Yeah.
You said the gate was closed. Have you got ground forces blocking the roads to Basra?
No.
Now, is there any way that they can get out that way?
No. That's why the gate's closed. Right here, yeah.
Is there a military or a political explanation as to why the Iraqis did not use chemical weapons?
We've had a lot of questions about why the Iraqis didn't use chemical weapons, and I don't know the answer. Well, I just thank God that they didn't.
They didn't use them because they didn't have time to react.
You want me to speculate? I'll be delighted to speculate. Nobody can ever pin you down when you speculate. Number one, we destroyed their artillery. We went after their artillery big time. They had major desertions in their artillery. And the artillery that would have been, and that's where how they would have delivered their chemical weapons, either that or by air, and we all know what happened to the air. So we went after their artillery big time, and I think we were probably highly, highly effective in going after their artillery. There's other people who are speculating that the reason why they didn't use chemical weapons is because they're afraid that if they use chemical weapons, there'd be nuclear retaliation. There's other people that speculate that they didn't use their chemical weapons because their chemical weapons degraded, and because of the damage that we did to their chemical production facilities, they were unable to upgrade the chemicals within their weapons as a result of that degradation. That was one of the reasons, among others, why we went after their chemical production facilities early on in the strategic campaign. I'll never know the answer to that question, but as I say, thank God that they didn't. All the way back in the back.
General, are you still bombing in northern Iraq? And if you are, what's the purpose of it now?
Yes. I'm sorry.
What's being achieved now?
Military purposes that we, is exactly the same things we were trying to achieve before. Okay, the war is not over. And you've got to remember, people are still dying out there. okay? And those people that are dying are my troops, and I'm going to continue to protect those troops in every way I possibly can until the war is over. Yes, sir, right here.
How soon after you've finally beaten those Republican guards and the other forces who threaten you, will you move your troops out of Iraq, either into Kuwait or back into Saudi?
That's not my decision to make.
Try and bring to justice the people responsible for the atrocities in Kuwait City. And also, could you comment on the friendly fire incident in which nine Britons were killed?
Yeah, I'm sorry, that was asked earlier and I failed to do that. First of all, on the first question, we have as much information as possible on those people that were committing the atrocities. And of course, we're going through a screening purpose, and whenever we find those people that did in fact commit those atrocities, we try and separate them out. We treat them no differently than any other prisoner of war, but the ultimate disposition of those people, of course, might be quite different than the way we would treat any other prisoner of war. With regard to the unfortunate incident yesterday, the only report we have is that two A-10 aircraft came in and they attacked two scout cars, British armored cars, and that's what caused the casualties. There were nine KIA. We deeply regret that. There's no excuse for it. I'm not going to apologize for it. I am going to say that our experience has been that based upon the extremely complicated number of different maneuvers that were being accomplished out here, according to the extreme diversity of the number of forces that were out here, according to this extreme differences in languages of the forces that are out here, and the weather conditions and everything else, I feel that we were quite lucky that we did not have more of this type of incident. I would also tell you that because we had a few earlier that you know about, that we went to extraordinary lengths to try and prevent that type of thing from happening. It's a terrible tragedy, and I'm sorry that it happened. I don't know. I'm sorry. I don't believe so, because I believe the information I had that a forward air controller was involved in directing that, and that would indicate that it was probably during the afternoon. But it was when there was a very, very close combat going on out there in that area. Yeah.
In the United Nations General Assembly is talking about peace. And as a military man, do you look at your challenge and you're going to get some satisfaction out of having achieved it. Is there some fear on your part that there will be a ceasefire that will keep you from fulfilling the assignment that you have? Is your assignment as a military man separate from the political goals of the...
Do I fear a ceasefire?
Do you fear that you will not be able to accomplish your ends, that there will be some political pressure brought on the campaign?
I think I've made it very clear to everybody that I just assume the war had never started, and I just assume never have lost a single life out there. That was not our choice. We've accomplished our mission, and when the decision makers come to the decision that there should be a ceasefire, nobody will be happier than me. All the way back in the back. We'll take a couple more questions and I have to go.
General, we were told today that an A-10 returning from a mission discovered and destroyed 16 Scuds. Is that a fact, and where were they located?
Most of those Scuds were located in western Iraq. I would tell you that we went into this with some intelligence estimates that I think I have since come to believe were either grossly inaccurate or our pilots are lying through their teeth, and I choose to think the former rather than the latter, particularly since many of the pilots have backed up what they've been saying by film and that sort of thing. But we went in with a very, very low number of these mobile erector launchers that we thought the enemy had. However, at one point we had a report that they may have had 10 times as many. I would tell you, though, that last night the pilots had a very, very successful afternoon and night as far as the mobile erector launchers, most of them in western Iraq, which would have been used against Israel. One question here? Yes, sir.
General, you've said many times in the past that you do not like body counts. You've also told us tonight that the enemy casualties were very, very large. I'm wondering, with the coalition forces already burying the dead on the battlefield, will there ever be any sort of accounting or head counts made or anything like that?
I don't think there's ever been, ever in the history of warfare, been a successful count of dead. And one of the reasons for the reason you say, and that's because it's necessary to lay those people to rest for a lot of reasons, and that happens. So I would say that no, there will never be an exact count. You know, but probably in the days to come, you're going to hear many, many stories, either overinflated or underinflated, depending upon who you hear them from. The people who will know best, unfortunately, are the families that won't see their loved ones come home. One more question right here. Yes, sir.
If the gate is indeed closed, as you've said several times, and the theories about where these Kuwaiti hostages are, perhaps Basra, perhaps Baghdad, where could they be? And a quick second question, was the timing for the start of the ground campaign a purely military choice, or it was a military choice with political influence on the final choice of date? Great.
When I say the gate is closed, I don't want to give you the impression that absolutely nothing is escaping. Quite the contrary, what isn't escaping is heavy tanks, what isn't escaping is artillery pieces, what isn't escaping is that sort of thing. That doesn't mean that civilian vehicles aren't escaping. That doesn't mean that innocent civilians aren't escaping. That doesn't mean that unarmed Iraqis aren't escaping. And that's not the gate I'm talking about. I'm talking about the gate that is closed on the war machine that is out there. Now, your other question was?
For the beginning of the ground campaign.
Okay, the timing for the beginning of the ground campaign. We made a military analysis of when that ground campaign should be conducted. I gave my recommendation to the Secretary of Defense and General Colin Powell. They passed that recommendation on to the President. The President acted upon that recommendation. Why, do you think we did it at the wrong time?
I'm wondering if your recommendation and analysis was accepted without change.
I'm very thankful for the fact that the President of the United States has allowed the United States military and the coalition military to fight this war exactly as it should have been fought, and the President in every case has taken our guidance and our recommendations to heart and has acted superbly as the Commander-in-Chief of the United States. Thank you very much.